heartland of America, the gateway to the West. This is Engineering Tomorrow, the podcast, keeping you entertained and in the know on the latest commercial and industrial heating, cooling, and water treatment technologies.
This is Brian Gonski, your host with the Engineering Tomorrow podcast. We are down in HVAC Valley in St. Louis, Missouri. It is a sweltering 100 degrees with 100% humidity. Those rooftop units are working overtime today, I would say. And we are fortunate enough to have Eric Eiler and Stephen Higgins of Midwest Machinery St. Louis. They are engineers by schooling and salesmen by trade. You'd call them a sales engineer. Today, we are going to be talking about boiler flu. And I'm going to go ahead, we're just going to jump right into it today and bring in the two experts. So, Stephen and Eric, tell me, what are the symptoms of boiler flu? Is it fever, coughing? What are we talking about?
All the above, Brian.
Oh, wait. Different type of flu, right?
It is.
Ha, ha, ha. Yeah, I'll go ahead and put the laugh track in and post. So Eric, did you just turn your microphone off?
I did. I just turned my microphone off, but I got it back on.
And you're not even putting the mic where I told you to hold the microphone.
Is this close now?
Yes.
Okay, perfect.
So since the last time you've been in here, we have a lot of new knobs and lights in the studio. Yeah. Eric, I know you were commenting on that.
It looks pretty fancy. We're getting very sophisticated with Engineering Tomorrow.
Yes, absolutely. I digress. Let's go back to boiler flu. What is boiler flu? I just go down to Home Depot and I just buy some PVC in the plumbing department and run it where I want, or is it more to it than that?
Well, there's a little more to it than that. Actually, PVC can be used for boiler flu, but there's a couple different types that we tend to look at. It really has to depend on the boiler that we're actually putting in and
in the application that you're using it in.
Yeah, where it's going to be ran. And, you know, everything.
What temperatures you're trying to achieve.
Right. So, I mean, as boilers have evolved here in the last few years, we've seen, you know, flue materials evolving. And I say in the last few years, I mean, 10, 15, but it's just kind of taken, you know, the unsexy products a little while to catch up as well, too. So.
Right. And they've been out there, but industry standard has always been PVC, CPVC. It's just been recently, right, that you've seen stainless steel enter the market.
Yeah, I mean, B-vent, that's what, like, right. If you go into your house, you'll see the old kind of aluminum-like material. I mean, that was the standard because it could handle hot temperatures, and you could also burn your hand on it, too, if you touched it. So, you know, becoming more efficient, being able to handle more efficient boilers, and becoming safer.
So we talked about in previous episodes these new finicky, high-energy efficient boilers. So did it take a while for the flu to catch up to that?
Yeah, I mean, I would say with the materials, the construction is caught up kind of quick, but how you implement it and your best practices, you know, you kind of had to learn by mistakes. It seemed like, you know, the flu manufacturers were evolving as, you know, the boilers were evolving as well.
So let's start with the basics. What are the top three or four types of materials in flu, and when do you use each?
Well, it's all dependent upon temperature. One of the main driving points is temperature. So you have your B-vent, which is your typical, what you're used to seeing in your house. That can handle very hot temperatures. That's for a non-condensing application, meaning your flu temperatures are going to be hot enough. There's never going to be condensation in there. Otherwise, it will corrode. And then you start to get into your condensing type applications, and those will be PVC, CPVC, polypropylene, or what is like an AL29-4C. It's a double wall stainless steel interior liner material.
Is that the same? I know in residential, depending on how many bends you have and the length, it's going to tell you the diameter of the piping. Is that the same?
Yes, that has a lot to do with it. It also has a lot to do with the size of the boiler. There will be specifics on what size that you're going to need and for how many, like, equivalent linear feet that you can run that size of, I guess, flue material.
It does kind of get into a little bit of the venting styles or the boiler style. So there's four categories of venting. If we kind of get into the weeds a little bit. There's, you know, the different categories basically revolve around, you know, natural drafting effect. We're going to let the temperatures pull the air up through, or we're going to have a forced air type draft. So,
yeah, but going back to the different types of materials and getting into temperatures, I guess the standard that we've seen is PVC can handle a maximum operating temperature of 149 degrees Fahrenheit. CPVC is a little bit better than that, can go up to 194, and then you have your AL294C, and that can handle all the way up to 550 degrees Fahrenheit. You know, you still need to consult with your boiler manufacturer off their recommendations, but this is just, I guess, a rule of thumb that we've seen.
Yeah, there's another material that's PPE or polypropylene. Not super common, just because I think of the cost standpoint currently, but it falls between CPVC and stainless. But when we've kind of tracked it down, pricing seems to be no less really than the stainless, which then you get, you know, shorter clearances to combustibles and everything with it. So it tends to be more advantageous to go AL294C.
Let's talk about, you know, once it's installed, what's going to have the least amount of troubles down the road after? I mean, because once it's installed, I'm guessing it could be behind walls, inaccessible. You know, what's the longest, best option for that?
Well, it depends on how you're going to operate your boiler is the main thing. So we've mentioned the materials can handle certain temperatures. Those temperatures are going to be dependent upon essentially what your entering water temperature to your boiler is. So all of the manufacturers will give you this information either in O&Ms or if you ask for it. Some of the boilers that we work with, you know, frequently tend to have a rule of thumb of anywhere between 15 to 30 degrees above the inlet water temperature. So if the water you're bringing back to the boiler is 150, you can expect it to be anywhere from 165 to 180 of flue gas temperature. So then you say, okay, if that's my flue gas temperature, then you figure out what material is, you know, the choice that you're going to run it in.
All right, so I'm a contractor. I don't like instructions. I'm just going to, you know, lick my finger and stick it in the air and just going to say I'm going to go with a 4-inch pipe, but it really should have been an 8-inch. What's going to happen if I put in a pipe or a diameter that's too small? Or does anything happen if it's too big?
I've not seen any problems when you oversize it, but undersizing it, imagine trying to take a drink out of a glass of water with a hose. You've got a lot of essentially extra static pressure built into it because it's so narrow, and you're going to have combustion issues with that because you're not going to be able to properly expel the flue material.
Yeah, and I think a lot of times with the oversizing, I might be incorrect on this, but if you're looking at natural draft applications, you can run into an issue if it's too large.
Right. Yeah, the heat kind of doesn't bottle up together.
It's not going to expel naturally like you would want it to. It's going to cling there, and then you're going to have combustion issues on that end.
What's the role of the sales rep in boiler post? I guess you would talk about pre-installation, installation, and post. What do you think, philosophically, what do you think the role of a sales rep should be in terms of making sure or not making sure that everything gets done right from start to finish? I don't think there's a right or wrong answer, and I think probably opinions will differ. What do you think? I'm just curious, what do you guys think the role should be, the sales rep?
You really need to look at your the boiler application and which boiler is going in. You need to start with that and learn, you know, what size it needs, what type of clearance you're going to have, and where it's going to go, how it's going to be expelled out of the building. Kind of looking at the design and working with the boiler manufacturer on what is the best solution for your boiler.
I would absolutely agree with that. And kind of adding to that, taking a look at what the engineer has put down on the paper, because they they have maybe given it a route, but they may not have understood, you know, some of the restrictions that we face with that venting. So they maybe have spec'd it as 8-inch, but realized that that boiler can only have 8-inch up to 100 equivalent feet. Well, they put a whole bunch of elbows in because we're going up through a chase. It may need to be larger. So I found it advantageous where we can actually draw up what they've had, have our flue manufacturer look at it, run a sizing program on it, and be able to potentially raise a red flag at it before it becomes a change order, becomes an issue. We can, you know, kind of say, hey, have you guys, you know, might want to take a look at this in the onset rather than after everything's been kind of all vetted out.
Especially if you're going to share common venting, if you're going to have a main header that your boilers are going to feed into, you're definitely going to need to consult with your manufacturer with the flue.
Right.
Talk to them about what they see and different applications and what size that you need, because that's going to change dramatically.
And that needs to be the flue manufacturer, not the boiler guys. Some of the boiler guys will say, or, you know, say, yes, we can handle this, but it needs to be looked at from, that's a system at that point in time. It needs to be looked at as such.
Tell me about these flue manufacturers. So we're not going to Depot or our local supply store and just buying material. What am I getting from a flue manufacturer, quote unquote, versus going out and buying some material and doing it, you know, quote unquote, ourselves as the contractor?
So there's two different types, really. I mean, your material can change as far as what type of stainless steel you're going to use. But then there's single wall and double wall. And essentially, double wall is the same as the single wall inner, but now it has a air gap in between the outer wall. And that will help with your clearance to combustibles and just being overall more safe in your building.
If you get up against it, you're not going to, you know, leave a big burn on your arm.
Right.
So if you go with the double wall, you've got... you can essentially put it up against things closer, or things can come to it closer versus single wall installation.
Correct. Now, typically what we see is within an inch. You'll still need an inch clearance between any combustible material, and you still need to check with your manufacturer before you do this, but I guess that's typically what we see in the industry.
You also get UL listed product. So it's been tested and verified as being acceptable and safe for that application.
And that's one of the biggest differences between stainless steel and CPVC and PVC is, you know, it is UL listed and it has a fire rating and a warranty. And you don't get that with your PVC or CPVC.
Mm-hmm. So tell me more about this. Who's, you know, if money were no object and you're putting a boiler in your building, it sounds like you may want to go with the double wall option.
Yes.
Tell me more about that. Who are the big players in that market? And then how do we go about getting a call and getting that sized? And tell me more about that process.
Well, so if money is not an option, there's different materials we can look at with the double wall. So they all have a stainless inner lining. And it's the outer coating, the one that you actually see, that changes with the dollar. So, you know, you'll start with your aluminized coating, which is, looks to some people like a galvanized. It's kind of a dull
right.
You know, sheen to it. And then you can transition to different grades of stainless, you know, 430, 316L. So that gives you more corrosion resistance. So if that material is then outside, which a portion of it will be, it'll last longer when it's exposed to the elements. But some of the main players, Metal Fab is one, Heat Fab, Schebler. There's a whole handful of those guys out there. Some of them do things better than others that you wouldn't see as being, you know, a big deal until it actually gets installed in the field and you start to have problems. So We're talking about an assembled system, so we're putting pieces of pipe together that are going to have hot temperatures potentially go through them, and semi-corrosive liquids. The flue condensate actually is acidic in pH, so it'll, if it gets through any of the joints or gaps or anything, it can actually cause corrosion issues on the outside of the material, and it's pretty unsightly when it's in your mechanical room. But the worst thing is if it gets through those joints when it's in, say, a chase or above a ceiling that's finished and has drywall. That's where some of the manufacturers and their sealant type and their joint connections stand out against the rest of them.
Yeah, and you really need to pay attention to your slope too. If you're going to have a big dip in your run, then that's going to be a big point where condensate is going to collect, and that's going to cause issues down the road. And we've seen that a lot. So that's why you need to also, you know, look at the application, make sure, you know, compare if you're doing condensing versus non-condensing and how you're going to make sure that that condensate is able to escape.
Does boiler fluid have traps?
It has drain sections, okay. Yes, and you can put those in. You can run it through a neutralizer, so it's safe to go directly out to drain.
That's actually something that I don't want to say I've seen frequently missed, but you know, it's kind of an afterthought, is to make sure that you have a drain section put in at your lowest point right next to your boiler. You need to understand if your boiler has its own drain or if it's designed to drain to the flue. Some of our kind of near condensing style don't have the means inside of the boiler itself to get rid of the condensate, so they actually slope to the actual flue material, with the thought that the flue is going to be able to handle that that little bit of extra condensate to dispel it. So drains actually really are important.
Yes, especially for a large riser stack, if you're going to common vent, I'd recommend looking at putting in a drain section. Ran into an issue just the other day with this, and it could have been avoided had they put a drain section right at that elbow before the riser.
Another kind of auxiliary item that I've seen recently that kind of goes along with the drain is actually a boiler test port. When you set up, you know, a boiler, you have to do a flue analyzation on it to make sure that your combustion is correct. So you've set your fuel air mixture right and it's burning how it should, not burning inefficiently. That test port is a place you have to just plug a probe into the flue. Well, with this double wall flue material, you're tapping through two sections. So How do you seal that back? I mean, if you're just going to manually go out there with a drill and pop a hole in it, well, you can plug that outside layer, but now you've perforated that interior layer and have no means to seal it up. So either make sure that there's a way you can have a test port included on the edge of your boiler before it goes from, single to double, because most boilers have an adapter piece there, Or have it taken into consideration on the flue material itself. So,
yeah. So then work with your manufacturer again on what can you do, but also make sure that you're aware that you do need that on your boiler. All right, Eric, you mentioned before, though, that some manufacturers do things differently than others as far as installation goes. What have you seen out in the field?
Well, Metalfab has a phenomenal joint where, thus far, the other manufacturers I've encountered have basically a flange-to-flange connection. So it's just a flat piece of metal against another flat piece of metal. And when you put sealant on the inside of that and push them together, if you're not very careful, you can slide that around. All of a sudden, now your sealant's thicker or thinner in certain spots. And then they have a V-band that clamps that kind of joint together. And that, if it's over-tightened, will basically oblong or oval shape that now joint area, which just creates a huge area for leakage.
Right.
With Metalfab's male-female connection, it's an extra material that's actually in there on the male section. So it stiffens it up and it causes an overlap. So if it's installed in the correct, direction, so that it's sloping the correct way, the condensate would have to run uphill to leak out of that. Plus, we've now added more material strengthening that joint, so when you wrap the V-band around it, it's a much stiffer joint and harder to, manipulate in an oval shape. We've seen it go in much more seamlessly because, it's got a top and a bottom, so it kind of takes away some of the guesswork. And it allows them to not over tighten it as much, which has been pretty cool thing to see go on the field, especially after I've come across a couple of pretty high profile projects now that used other manufacturers' brands that they have just been chasing leak after leak because is it leaking on the inside? Is it leaking on, you know, I mean, it could be leaking at one joint, you know, three sizes up, but not coming out until, you know, three joints down. So you're just chasing this moisture around and can tear up carpets and drywalls and everything if it's in chases.
Yeah, I've seen a lot of ceiling panels that are stained, mm-hmm. and that's definitely an issue.
Tell me about installation time on the prefab. Same, longer, shorter?
If we have gotten the chance to put together a drawing and have the, you know, the engineer and or mechanical contractor kind of double check that, we'll take that, have manufacturer give us a CAD file, and it literally gives a piece by piece installation of it. So you just have to look and say, I take this 12-inch piece and I connect it to this 36-inch piece. It takes the guesswork completely out of it. So compared to like putting a PVC or CPVC where you're measuring and cutting and gluing, I mean, I would say it's equal, if not significantly faster.
Yeah, there is a learning curve though.
Right.
Once you start doing it, it will go a lot faster. And with the male-female connection, what that really helps you on is your horizontal sections. So vertical sections, you don't really have a lot of issues with,
leaks,
you know,
right.
Yeah, butting those up and having that be a nice flange to flange connection. But in the horizontals, that can be a problem, especially with different material that doesn't have that male-female interlocking connection.
All right, I want to segue to my favorite part of the show. We don't do this every week, but I feel like there could be some good horror stories you guys have seen out in the field in the past with flu. So rapid fire, what do you got? What is the worst thing you've seen? We're not going to name names here, but tell me something you've seen.
Well, I haven't actually seen this, but I talked to a service contractor that was saying that he was installing a lot of boilers and they didn't look at the drain section. And they had all the condensate run right back through the boiler. Well, it was a non-condensing boiler, and it ruined it pretty quickly. And that was a nightmare for pretty much everyone involved. And, you know, it couldn't pin it on one person exactly because...
it's always the rep's fault, regardless. It doesn't matter whether it was the engineer, the owner, the contractor. At the end of the day, it's always the rep's fault. Right,
right. And that's why we're here to tell you to look out for these. Not my fault anymore.
Yeah. Yeah, once everyone's listened to this podcast, this is it wipes our slate clean, right?
Right. Dispelling all. I'd say, as of recent, man, I got called out to look at some flue that was installed. Another manufacturer that didn't have a male female, and it's been leaking for 6 years, and they have been chasing the leaks for 6 years.
Not
a fault of the installing contractor, not a fault of the engineer's design, just the inability to make that an easy installation. I mean, the harder something is to install, the harder it's going to be to get correct, mm-hmm. I mean, even if you are diligent about it. And so it goes up through three stories in a building in a chase. Well, the chase was built around it. So now that the building is in operation and has been for the last 6 years, it's now leaking up on the third floor. So it goes through three stories of chase, all drywalled in. It's leaking through the roof or through the ceiling, the wall, and into the carpet. And
they have
no way to figure out where that is. So they have to go back and rip all of this out through three stories to try to put something else back in because they've even gone to the point of where they thought they knew where all the leaking was. They pressure tested with water. They filled the whole thing with water to show, hey, look, I have no leaks. Come back 48 hours later and it's leaking again.
Oh, wow.
So it's just a service contractor's nightmare. Constant callbacks.
That's nothing a can of Flex Seal couldn't fix.
It's just the whole thing. Just Flex Seal
the whole thing and you're good to go.
Works on a boat with a screen door.
That's right. All right, guys. You've probably seen it all. Is there anything we want to avoid or think about in venting locations when you're terminating outside?
sidewall venting is kind of a little beast of its own. You know, we're used to venting everything up because of the older style boilers. We had to, you know, draft them up and out. So sidewall venting is a newer thing that we have with these condensing boilers, and you're basically introducing a warm, moist, you know, gaseous material out into a cold, dry climate. You're basically creating a big steamy area, billowing cloud. So sidewall venting, where that goes is very important. You don't want it over a walkway where people are going to be, or, you know, some people think it's unsightly. They think it's smoke. So it's an important one.
Yeah, I would imagine there's nothing worse than walking by on a hot day and then getting even hotter, humid,
getting
moist
a blast
air blasted at you while you're walking down the street. Anything else?
No, that's about it. Just probably need to be cognizant of how you're exhausting, where it's coming out of the building, and what type of terminations that you're using. And if it's susceptible to rain, make sure you have a cap on there.
Yeah, I mean, I think the biggest thing is, or one of the biggest takeaways is, ask us questions about this. It's not just an auxiliary piece that we put on. And yes, it goes on at the end of the project, but there's a lot more to it than, you know, meets the eye. And we can help the project go much better if we're involved and you just ask the questions. You know, it's our job to know and have the information. So let's get it right on the onset. Instead of, you know.
Thanks for having me again, Brian.
Thanks,
well,
Brian.
Thanks for wrapping up the show for me. I guess I won't ask any more questions. All right. Well, I'd like to thank our live studio audience for being here and watching the podcast. You know, visit our blog, engineeringtomorrow.blog. And we do a lot of great written pieces, and we have a lot of great downloadable content and useful resources for boilers and cooling towers and anything you can imagine with HVAC. Until next time, thank you for listening to our 7th episode, and we will see you again.
You've been listening to Engineering Tomorrow, the podcast. For more insights and downloadable content, please visit our website at www.engineeringtomorrow.blog. Until next time, engineer for tomorrow, today.